WOLB Baltimore and WERQ FM HD3 Baltimore, celebrating Radio 1's 42nd anniversary.
Our Radio 1 family, our employees, their family members, our listeners, our viewers, our extended family.
And serving the African American community for over 42 years.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
Here we are every Friday from 10 to 12 here on 1010 WOLB, the Frank M. Conway Sr. NL Show with co-host Attorney Tama Smith Wilson.
Good morning, Baltimore. I'm Tama Smith Wilson. Glad to be here with you for another week, another Friday. I'm an attorney and small business owner in Baltimore City. If you need to contact me, I can be reached at 667-334-7242. 667-334-7242. And during the show, if you have any questions or comments and you can't get through in the phone line, please feel free to text me and we will include you in our conversation.
All righty. Anything special that you want to talk about today?
Yesterday, I went to an event sponsored by Be More News, the Joe Man's Black Wall Street Award At that event, my nonprofit organization, The Door, was recognized for its Community Service Award. And also, Mr. Jason Rodriguez, our assistant chief engineer, was recognized for his work in radio and his work in the community. So I just wanted to say congratulations, Jason. It's been a pleasure working with you, and I look forward to continue working with you in the future. Mr. DeShiel was there. What do you think about the event?
I think it was a good event, and I think the people that were that received awards, they were well deserved. Both you, The Door, and Jason, I was happy to see it, and it presents yet an opportunity for us to get to know one another and to do some more one anothering. So I thought it was a great time.
So I want to say thank you to your team and to Mr. Donnie Glover as well.
Oh, my nephew, Donnie, huh?
Yes.
Now, you mentioned the name of the, well, I heard Joe Mann's name in there.
Joe Mann's Black Wall Street Award.
Yeah, I knew Joe. If it's the same Joe, yeah. I knew Joe well. Great guy.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
He was a great guy. Joe happened to do a plaque for me that we presented to Aretha Franklin in Detroit. And I was telling him when we were getting the flag, I said, man, your plaque going directly to Aretha. Okay. And our other co-host, Attorney Robert Bob DeShiel.
Good morning, Baltimore. I'm happy to be here. You know what I do. And my number is 410-547-8820. But I do want to mention that 2023 is a year of particular significance for me. If I live to November, it will mark the 50th anniversary of my having been admitted to practice law in the state of Maryland and in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania.
Okay. That means we started at the same time.
And if I live 2 weeks more into the first week of December, it will mark the 75th anniversary of my place here on this earth.
All right.
Now, so my mantra for the year is I'm not taking any prisoners. There are those who say I've never done that, but I just want you to know.
I go along with them.
If I appear to be dispassionate and so forth, it's not my fault. It's just I'm getting old.
I don't know about that part, but certainly you deserve all the accolades that can be shined upon you.
Thank you.
Yours truly here, Carlton C. Douglas, of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, the telephone number to call is 410-669-1738. Specializing in at-need, pre-need, pre-arrangements, seminars, veteran benefits, veterans, please get your DD-214, cremations, and you know the drill. Everybody need to get some insurance, or you need to increase what you have. Now, we have several people on the line. We got one line open, but we have a special guest we want to get to first. And when we are finished with our guest, we will be coming to... Oh, my niece is on there, Daphne Austin. Okay, Daphne, Jean, Brother Haki, Cliff, and you got one line open. Okay, I'm going to now call on my co-host, Attorney Tamer Smith-Wilson, to introduce our special guest.
Our special guest today is a gentleman by the name of Mr. Wallace Beal. He has everything that you need to know about apprenticeships. He's in charge of an apprenticeship readiness program. If you know any young adults who is trying to get a career, not just a job, but a career in one of the trade areas, Mr. Beal is someone you need to know, someone you need to contact. Get your pen out, get your paper out so you can take notes. And when he comes on, he will have plenty of information to share with you about this program and the opportunities that are available to anyone in Baltimore, if not the state of Maryland, over the age of 18.
Okay, let's go. Mr. Beal, are you there?
Good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Beal. How are you? Can you please give us information about your Raising the Bar Apprenticeship Readiness Program?
Okay. This program is a 3-week program that was created by the union about 7 years ago. It's really a well-kept secret. During the 3 weeks, we prepare you to get into 3 to 5 year apprenticeship as a carpenter, a plumber, bricklayer, insulator, sheet metal operating engineers, male and female. You have to be 18 years plus. You need to have a high school diploma or GED. You got to have a driver's license. Got to be able to pass a drug test. The reason we generated this program is because there was a myth going around that nobody in the Baltimore, Washington area wanted to get into construction. We found out that not to be true. Our goal is for you to get in the program, finish. Once you finish, you take a physical, and depending upon which program you signed up for, you get paid. These programs are paid programs. In the union, the goal is for you at the end of the 5 years, your license, we want you making $100,000. We'll start you between 16 and 18. You'll get a $2 to $4 raise every year to get to the top salary. The top salary right now for plumbers is about, I don't know, $49 an hour. Carpenters is about $39. Operating engineers is somewhere in the mid-30s. We need young people. I tell them I'm looking for people who are ready, willing, and do construction. This is not Home Depot construction. It's if it's 5 below, you're working. If it's 105 above, you're working. But you get paid. You work your 40 hours, and then you go to class. But when you go to class, you get paid. We run this program twice a year. We look between 16 and 18 people in the class. This year, the class is going to be run down in Sparrows Point. We're looking for first pick. We're looking for people who want to do this as a career, and we prepare you. We make sure that you are OSHA ready. We make sure you're CPR ready. We make sure that we prepare you mathematically, give you 40 hours of math, so that regardless of who exam you take, you pass. Normally, after the 3 weeks, 2 weeks later, you start. This program was designed to cut through all the red tape. You can go and sign up for a union apprenticeship, but it normally takes 3 or 4 months before they make a decision. 98% of the people that go through this program get in, they start to work. Like I said, our goal is for you to make $100,000. It's free. I make a joke with the students. Only thing they owe me is a cold Pepsi, 16 ounce or 20. We ask people to show up every day during the 3 weeks from 8 to 4, Monday through Friday. We'll also give them some sort of a stipend toward gas. We need talent. These opportunities are fairly new to us, and I don't think they'll be around forever. We're really looking for women for construction because somebody's telling them that they can't do it, and we found that's not true. You don't need to have experience. You need to have desire to do this as a career. Like I said, most of these programs are 5 years, and you're paid. You don't go into any debt, right? As long as you're 18 years of age, got a license, and a desire to have a career in one of these. I'm all about trying to help us get into this because it's been around a long time, and we truly have not had the access over these years that we should have. But now we have the opportunity. I'm pumped up. Our next class, what we do, we have info sessions. Our next info session will be next Wednesday, January the 18th at 6 o'clock. What you do is they contact me. I send them a flyer. You scan the QR code, sign up, and I'll see you on the 18th. You learn about the program. If you're interested in the program, we schedule you to take a math and reading exam. Once you pass that, we schedule you for the class for March 13th until the 31st.
Mr. Beal, let me ask you a quick question.
Go ahead, sir.
The jobs you're talking about are obviously not jobs provided by the...
Hey, Bob, identify yourself first he'll know who you
are. I'm sorry. This is Robert DeShiel. How you doing?
How you doing?
I came to Baltimore in 1975 as a labor side union attorney. So my question is, the jobs that you're talking about are not jobs for the union. They're jobs for the companies that are parties to collective bargaining agreements with the union. So the question is, what percentage of the construction companies in the Baltimore area are actually unionized versus those that are open shop and not unionized?
That I don't know, sir. I'd be lying if I told you I knew that percentage. I don't know. because I'm aware you have a non-union group. I think it's called ABC, and then you have the union. We're just blessed that 95% of the people we have go to work.
Okay. And so I just wanted to make sure that our listening audience was not confused and thinking that they could go down to the union hall and automatically would have a job. The jobs are provided by the employers, and their apprenticeship programs offered by, as you say, the ABC, and also I think the Associated General Contractors offers apprenticeship programs as well. But I will quickly acknowledge that historically the quickest way to the middle income status in terms of income is through an organized and concerted effort to raise the wages of the working class. And in this country and around the world, unionization has proven to be the most effective tool for accomplishing that end.
Tama?
Mr. Bill, I know a lot of people, when they think of going back and getting a trade, they're thinking about being 18 or 21 or just entering the work field. However, if someone is in their 30s or 40s and they want to make a career change and they say, well, at my current job, I can't get to $100,000 in the next 5 years, let me consider something different. Is this an opportunity for them as well?
Yes. We, in our last class, we put a gentleman that's 52, and he's in the electrical apprenticeship. Yes. As long as you can physically do the work, what we want you to be able to is have at least a minimum of 10 years to make this money. So if you're 55 and you want to work for 10 more years to you're 65, that's fine. This program is open from 18 really to almost 60 if you can do the work.
And is another goal not just to get in, do the work, make money, but will they be able to start their own business after they achieve what
yes.
they have through this program?
Once you complete the apprenticeship itself, we recommend that you take, there's so many more working hours than you get your master's license. Because before you can start your business, you have to get your master's license. I personally have a goal. If once you complete the apprenticeship, if you choose to continue to working with the union, fine. If you want to start your own business, fine. Just hire union workers into your business.
Any other questions?
No other questions for me. Okay. Can you give them your contact information?
Yeah, Mr.
Yes.
Beal.
My name is Wallace Beal Jr. They can contact me at 443-226-7826. And the program is Raising the Bar.
Give it again, Mr. Beal.
My name is Wallace Beal Jr., 443-226-7826, and is Raising the Bar, and our next info session will be next Wednesday, January the 18th.
Where?
The actual classes start March the 13th for 3 weeks.
Now, the info session, can you tell us where that is, or how do you...
It's Zoom.
Oh, Zoom,
once
okay.
Once you sign up,
okay.
You go on Zoom at 6 o'clock.
Okay.
You get to ask the questions of us, and if you are interested, you sign up, then I schedule you to take the exam, the math and reading exam, which are held over at Huber Memorial Church.
I got one question for you, Mr. Beal.
Go ahead, sir.
I got a full board here.
I understand.
Are you getting many persons who are like coming out of Mervo, Carver, Emerson, Westside Skills Center, places like that?
No.
Okay. And why do you think that is?
My last two classes, I got a few people from Emerson Westside. No. The Votech School students, no. We don't get many of them.
That's interesting.
Why do you think that is?
I think that many of the students have, even in the class, the Votech classes today, the gentleman said he was 75. I'm 75, too. The Votech classes of today are not like the Votech classes when we went to school. You know, you spent time at Mervo when I was younger. They built the building. The trades came together. They built the building and sold it. The type of program today are different. So they are not as prepared as they could be.
Hmm. okay. Well, thank you, Mr. Bill. We certainly
no problem.
Thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to be on here and to give our listening audience information that they so desperately need.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Opportunities are there for everybody in Lottie-Dottie. So please contact me, and we will get you in a position to have a career.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Bill. And thank you, Tamer, for inviting him on. Okay, we get ready. Come to the phones. WOLB streams live at WOLBBaltimore.com. WOLB streams live at WOLBBaltimore.com. That means if you can't listen to us too good on the radio, you can get us on by way of the internet. If you want to call in, the number to call in is 410-481-1010. That's 410-481-1010. We have a lot of things to talk about today. When we come to the phones, we're coming in this order. Daphne, Austin, Gene, Brother Hockey, Cliff, and Carlos. But before we do, I want you to hear the first clip for today that happened the other day with the first African-American to be head of the Democratic Party, Mr. Hakeem Jeffries. There's a lot of other things out there going on. Ivan Bates seemed to be Bob and Tamer coming in, sitting right, going to work. He's exonerated the police officers in that killing of the young man. I understand this morning he's exonerated that security guard that was in that shooting up in Pimlico. And he's going to have to make a decision soon on the Adnan Syed situation. So he's coming in with feet, hitting the floor, guns blasting. But before we come to you all on the phone, I would like to hear clip one, please, first. Clip one.
The American people, understandably, after the events of this week, recognize that the Congress is at a fork in the road and are asking the question, what direction will we choose? On this first day, I do not pretend to answer that question on behalf of my colleagues on the other side of the aisle, but we do extend our hand of partnership to you and want to make clear that we extend and intend to try to find common ground whenever and wherever possible on behalf of the American people. Not as Democrats, not as Republicans, not as independents, but as Americans. But I also want to make clear that we will never compromise our principles. House Democrats will always put American values over autocracy, benevolence over bigotry, the Constitution over the cult, democracy over demagogues, economic opportunity over extremism, freedom over fascism, governing over gaslighting, hopefulness over hatred, inclusion over isolation, justice over judicial overreach, knowledge over kangaroo courts, liberty over limitation, maturity over Mar-a-Lago, normalcy over negativity, opportunity over obstruction, people over politics, quality of life issues over QAnon, reason over racism, substance over slander, triumph over tyranny, understanding over ugliness, voting rights over voter suppression, working families over the well-connected, Xenial over xenophobia. Yes, we can over you can't do it. And zealous representation over zero-sum confrontation. We will always
do the right thing by the American people. So let us not grow weary of doing good, for the American people will reap the benefit of the harvest if we do not give up. God bless you, God bless the House, and God bless the United States of America.
All right. That was the Honorable Hakeem Jeffries, the first African American to be minority leader of the Democratic Party. With his speech the other day, I thought it was very kind of telling of what his leadership might be about. Of course, the Republicans won the House. They are in charge under McCarthy, but the Democrats still hold the Senate. Also out there is the fact that U.S. inflation falls 6 months in a row. The big thing happening in national news now is that they found some documents that President Biden should not have had, or nobody reported that he had it. And, of course, it's creating a stir on the Republican side. Of course, they ain't have much to say when it was concerning their own Mr. Trump. But now that it's on Biden's side, they got a lot to say. Barbara State's Attorney Ivy Bates dismisses charges against Keith Davis. And that's what I was talking about, the Pimlico homicide case. He's going to have to make some decisions soon because the case of Adnan Syed is getting ready to go to the appeals court of Maryland. And he's going to have to defend what Marilyn Mosby has done in that case. Also, some of you may remember Mr. Herr. I think his name Ben Herr. Is it Ben Herr?
No.
It's not Ben Herr. Well, whatever Mr. Herr's name. Robert Herr. I'm sorry. Not Ben. Ben was the Roman.
Yeah, he's a chariot.
Yeah, guy. He was a chariot man. Yeah. Robert Herr, some of you may remember, he was the United States Attorney here in Maryland.
Yep.
And he has been appointed by the Attorney General, Merrick Garland, to oversee this situation, pro-Biden's documents that were found. The Ravens is still trying to hold on to being in the playoffs. They play again Cincinnati this Sunday night. On the way here, I was hearing some discussion about some teams that might want to pay Lamar that $240 million, the three teams being Atlanta, the Texans, and it's one more. I'll come up with it later, but I know it's at least three of them that the owners might consider paying that $240 million that he wants that I don't think the Ravens want to pay. Okay? And many other things to discuss. Might be something you want to discuss. The homicide rate already this year, and we're in the 13th day, we already have about 7 to 8 homicides already, which is ridiculous, which is going to bring me to my first caller for today. And like I said, again, we're coming in this order. Daphne, Jean, Brother Haki, Cliff, and Carlo. Let's start off with Daphne. Hello, Niecy.
Good morning, Uncle Carson. How are you, dear?
Fine, sweetheart.
Uncle Carson, I called on the radio just to say good morning and happy New Year's to everybody. And hopefully this year we can get off with a good start. And let's not talk so much about murders and stuff, but saving the lives, you know, that are here. Everybody doing their part to help keep these young people alive as best as they can. And I said, I wasn't going to discuss anymore. But you just said something to me just lit me on fire, that Mr. Ivan Bates exonerated Keith Davis. That's been going on, 5 or 6 years?
Mm-hmm.
In the court, out the court, in the court. There are over 300 families, probably 500 families of murder victims in the state of Maryland who none of us ever even got an arrest and never even seen a courthouse, and they have spent tireless money and time fooling around with this case. I'm not saying he's guilty or he's not guilty. What I'm saying is we got to get away from this playing politics with our children's lives. It's going to stop as of today. I'm going to get as many women as I can get together, moms, to make some noise.
Daphne, identify your organization so everybody know.
Mothers of Murdered Sons and Daughters United Incorporated, where there's thousands of mothers in the state of Maryland who have lost their children since this gun violence. And I don't think over 200 of them have went to court. That's despicable. And then they're letting people go free? What a smack in the face to all of us. Make that stuff private. But in his speech, and when him and Zico and them did a press conference, I saw it live on Facebook, and I had tears in my eyes because the first promise that he made, and he didn't say it, but Z Cohen said it, that they was going to free Keith Davis. My phone rang off the hook for weeks about that. Enough is enough with playing politics with our children and our children's lives. This is sickening to me. I'm almost don't want to go in my job. I'm so upset. So what about that everybody has a right to call Ivan Bates up and ask for their child to be free? Well, there's a lot of people in there that are still claiming they're innocent. The cases that make the news are the cases that everyone is interested in, the high profile, and this is why none of us got justice for our children. Now, what would it be like if I get all these moms together? All these moms together, and we do an insurrection at all these places that's not getting our cases done and stuff.
It's got to stop. May I ask a question?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Is there a difference that you, in your mind, between justice and vengeance? Are those two terms synonymous? And what do they mean to you in the context of the criminal, so-called criminal justice system?
The so-called criminal justice, I understand, you know, what you're saying. As me, as a mother who lost their child and
Let me ask a better way.
Ask me a better thing.
When you seek justice, are you really seeking vengeance? That's the question. Does justice mean vengeance?
Nowadays it does.
Well,
didn't used to.
Why? I don't know why do you say it didn't used to?
Because if the law is, if we're not going to get justice through the courthouse, then the streets are serving the justice, and people need to understand that. When we first get that news of our loved one being murdered senselessly or something like that, we're not saying praise the Lord or God, we're saying, I'm putting my head to say, get it taken care of, because that's the state of mind that we're in.
Well, if the system is supposed to produce justice, doesn't that mean you have to surrender your personal sense of vengeance? Doesn't mean you have to give up that. In other words, and there was a time where, you know, an eye for eye, whatever you want to say, you kill me, I kill you. That's street justice. But we're supposed to surrender that in exchange for a system where the outcome is more predictable, where it's uniform, where it's consistent to apply to everybody. So how can we have such a system if personal vengeance is the only thing that's going to satisfy us?
Well, because we don't see the system working, sir.
Well, the system is the people that we put in place to make it work. The system doesn't have any life of its own. If the system doesn't work, that means we put the wrong people there, or the people there aren't doing
it. And we
the
need
job.
To get them out.
Yeah.
Yeah. I agree with that.
Well, I understand what y'all say about that, but have any of you ever lost a child to gun violence?
No, and I hope I never
do. You can't possibly know what goes through our minds.
I lost a father who was shot at point blank range sitting in his own car.
Right.
Okay.
And what were your reactions, sir?
I was natural. What would anybody's reaction be? But that doesn't mean I have a right to go out and shoot the person that did it. And that doesn't mean I should demand that the system.
I understand exactly what you say.
Okay.
But for the last 30 or 40 years, there is no justice, and because the public does not get involved, they don't say what they see. They want to do it this way, and this is why the numbers are so alarming,
okay.
And this is why the work is not getting done. It has nothing to do with politicians. It's got to do with personal decisions that people are making.
Daphne, before
now,
you...
This is,
Daphne, because I got a full line here. I got to go on.
Okay.
But you all still have your meetings. Give wins, because there might be some families out there that want to get with your group and let them know where they can come, when you meet, what time, and all that.
Well, right now, as of December the 31st, I've closed up the mom house. We will be meeting different places. I don't have that outline.
Okay, well, just get it to me, and when you want me to announce it, just get it to me.
I'll make sure I get it to you.
All right, sweetie.
And have a blessed day.
You too, sweetheart.
You too.
Okay. Let's go to, we got a line open, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. Gene, you're on air. Gene, you're on.
Hey, happy Friday, everybody.
Same to you.
Yeah, I just want to, in response to the clip that you played, was it 15 votes, Carlton? And I think the record is something like 42 votes in 1839, you know, to get, you know, so that a particular party could, you know, perform their will. Okay, so... Mark Meadows, this is what Mark Meadows said, and I did a podcast and I posted this. He said, if he told you who were the members of the Freedom Caucus, he would have to kill you. So, you know, just benchmark that and hold on to that one. Okay, so earlier in the week,
I heard. I mean, everybody know who, you can find out who's on the Freedom Caucus. That's no problem.
I can and you can, but yeah. I'm just saying that, again, you know, some of the statements I'm going to make is people that don't do their research.
Oh,
man.
Okay.
And I give you an example. Martin Luther King, thank the mayor for, you know, having for parade.
Yes.
I want to say that.
Yes, we give him kudos for that.
Yeah. And so in reference to Martin Luther King, somebody brought up, Bayard Runyon.
Rustin.
People who don't know who...
Bayard Rustin.
Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm.
Who was a homosexual, and that's the point that they made. I'm thinking, you know, okay, so he's LGBTQ, whatever, he's gay. Also was arrested for performing a lewd and lascivious act. But the point I want to make is when I brought up last week in reference to the speech, the ACLC speech, where do we go from here, and the economic component, Bayard Rustin was, and also the war against Vietnam speech, go to the mountaintop speech, which was done second. You know, Bayard, Mr. What's his last name again?
Rustin.
Mr. Rustin was also a conscientious objector.
Right.
Going back to like 1962, 63.
Mm-hmm.
And Dr. King became cognizant of this in 1967 or evolved, you know, doing and spoke out against it in 1967. My ex and her family have moved to Atlanta. They went to the King Center. Another thing, just in reference to Dr. King, is that Dr. King's mother was killed in Ebenezer Baptist Church. She was shot in front of, I don't think it was the church service, but there
was.
I think it was in the middle.
No, it
was
the
church service going on.
Yeah, she was she was at the organ when the guy came in, walked straight down and shot her.
Yep, critical race theory. See, this is critical race theory is more than just, you know, what they teach in college, and that we need to teach these to white people. We need to teach it to our people. The Freedom Riders. I heard somebody talking about the Freedom Riders. Diane Nash. Do you guys have a clue who Diane Nash was?
No.
Well, Diane Nash, she was an 18-year-old young lady who was down at Fisk University, where they were training to do the sit-ins, and where they were teaching them, you know, like when the white people come in and they put a cigarette out in your on your head and spit on you or whatever because you're eating at the counter, you know, this is how you react to this, right? Young Diane Nash.
We need you to get to the point that you're trying to make.
My
point is critical race theory. You got a full board, great. But again, we need to teach the whole history and stop holding back, stop being scared.
I agree.
To tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth. So help me God. So you guys have a great weekend.
Thank you, Gene. Well, I think everybody in this room agree on that.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody is aware of the fact that critical race theory is not in the school system. It has never been taught in public schools. That, and we have two lawyers here, both of you guys have been to law school. From what I understand, it is only taught in law school. Am I correct?
I don't even know what it is, so I can't answer the question. From what I believe is something that was concocted by a group of people who objected to white kids being, or all kids being taught the truth about the legacy and the history of slavery in this country.
Well, the understanding I got is that the critical race theory was only being taught in law schools. That's what I got.
I didn't have it in law school.
No, there's no such thing as the critical. I'm telling you, it's a fiction. It was a concoction of those who want to deny white supremacy and deny that this country owes a debt to black people based on slavery.
Okay.
That's who created the theory. It's not something to be taught to anybody because it's a fiction and it's a lie.
Okay. All right. Well, we got a clearance on that then. Let's go to Brother Hakeem. Brother Hakeem, you're on air.
Yes, sir. Good morning, Carlton. Good morning, Brother DeShields and Sister Attorney Tamay. How you say? I'm sorry.
Tama.
Pleasure. Thank you. I appreciate that. Just want to, you know, give people a heads up. Speaking about Dr. King, the Caucus of African American Leadership will have its breakfast. I'm sorry, not breakfast. It's dinner, actually, tonight at La Fontaine Blue in Glen Burnie. So for those that are coming, look forward to seeing you there.
Who's the speaker, Brother Hockey? Is there a speaker?
Bernie Thompson, the congressman from Mississippi.
Oh, Benny Thompson.
Thank you. Benny, right. Benny Thompson. And, of course, everybody know the legislative session just started on 2 days ago. Yesterday, 2 days ago, I was down there for opening day. So it's time for work 24/7, 365 days a year, right, Brother Carlton?
That's right. Yeah.
But I also wanted to mention, and I appreciate Brother Gene, he mentioned the Dr. King, memorial down in, Atlanta. I appreciate that. But last year, 2022, we, my organization, Teaching Artists Institute, we brought 31 young people leaving Baltimore, stopping in D.C. at the African American Museum, as well as Greenville, South Carolina. And that's where Reverend Jesse Jackson is from. And, you know, many people, you know, don't make the connections. And you know, it's been a good week for me just listening to, you know, people speak about it. And I'll close and I'll say that recently in Baltimore, I just encourage everybody still, you know, Reverend Al Sharpton has, you know, kind of held the line with this, you know, civil rights movement. And we did the screening for his film, Loudmouth. And now, and appreciate Senator Larry Young and, the president of NAN, and my aunt is Dr. Miriam Summers, who's the vice president. And we look forward. Now they want to show it in churches over the weekend and over the next couple days. So that's what we need to do, brothers and sisters, and keep this movement going. All right?
Brother Hockey.
Yeah.
Is the movie in town? Because I didn't know anything about the screening, because I sure would have loved to have been there. But
I called on the radio and said, maybe I didn't follow up if I did.
Yeah, you didn't follow up.
Yeah. No.
But is it in town now or what?
Let me find out if it's still in certain theaters, but I know it's actually on Amazon as well.
I think I got Amazon Prime.
I'm sure most people got Amazon Prime.
I got so many streaming services, I'm going to cut some of these suckers out.
I feel you. So I'll close and say yes. Okay. So we're looking forward to doing the Freedom Rides again this year, June 11th through the 16th. We're looking for some young people and some adults. Last year, Delegate Salima Maria, at 80 years old, went strong with us for 7 days. And she was the curator. So thank you very much, Baba. Appreciate you.
Thank you, Brother Hakeem. Line open, 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. We're going to Cliff. Cliff, you're on air. Cliff? Cliff once. Cliff twice. Then you have to call back, Cliff. Going to Brother Carlos. We got two lines open. 410-481-1010. That's 410-481-1010. Brother Carlos, you're on air.
Yeah. Thank you, and Happy New Year to everybody.
Same to you.
I just have a couple quick comments. I want to know from Brother Haki, who is a paramedic, and this is what from his knowledge. I want to know why so many black people are dying in the hands of paramedics, of white paramedics across the nation, for some reason, for inattention, for lack of medical care, CPR and stuff like that at the point of contact. Sometime next week he could expound and let us know something from his knowledge.
What is the factual predicate for the question? Why should we believe you when you say that black people are dying at the hands of paramedics? Where do you get that information?
Okay, if I have a chance to expound on this,
okay, go ahead.
I'm looking at a case. Cases like Michael Brown from Ferguson, who was laying in the street for 4 hours without any medical attention. I'm looking at Ronald Green.
Before you leave Michael Brown, what do paramedics have to do with him laying in the street for 4 hours before they got there?
Because either the police or whoever the authorities were in charge did not send out paramedics to conduct a medical emergency exam at the point where he was supposedly killed.
Well, wait a minute, Brother Carlo. From what, and I kind of followed that case kind of closely. From what I understand, when they shot the boy, the paramedics did come. It was that the police did not give him any treatment like the people felt that he should have gotten. And when they got there, when the paramedics did get there, he was declared deceased. Right. Now, I do agree with you on the fact that they took too long letting that man lay in the street for 5 hours before they came and removed the remains to go to the medical examiner. But from what I understand, medical authorities did come and found out, you know, he was deceased on the scene. And the basic argument was, why didn't the police do something to try to revive him? Not the fact that nobody showed up.
Or not that the paramedics did something.
Yeah.
Well, again, like I say, the evidence that I have seen goes to the contrary. As to black victims not receiving the same attention from CPR and medical care at the point, at the street, on the street level, that white people get.
Well, could you give us, let me ask you this then. So we won't prolong this. Can you give us evidence of where we can go to find the same information so we can be knowledgeable about what you're talking about?
Yeah, go to YouTube. Go to YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
There was a recent case of an individual who was having some kind of mental issue and what have you. Paramedics rolled him out of the house, told him to get on the gurney, and he could not. Then they threw him on the gurney, strapped him face down, strapped him into the gurney, and he suffocated and asphyxiated. And the paramedics have been brought up on charges, first-degree murder charges.
Okay.
That's the most recent case.
Okay.
Ronald Green in Louisiana, and the paramedics have a responsibility. Ronald Green was at the point of death when the police beat him. The paramedics came out to offer him attention. Police waved them on. Now, what authority did police have to wave them on when this man was at the point of death and needed medical attention? So go to your YouTube and see these different events. I mean, they're all over the place. And it's black people. That's black people that are suffering. And I want to know, Brother Haki can give us some inside information.
Yeah. Brother Haki, okay, if you are listening, Brother Haki, please call in. In fact, I will allow you on the second hour, Brother Haki, because we don't let you, anyone, if you call once, that's it. But if you have any of this information that Brother Carlos is asking about, I will allow you to call in at 11 o'clock for it. If not, and you need to retrieve this information, then please call in next week with some answers for Brother Carlos.
Okay, I appreciate that. And let me just a couple little preliminary mm-hmm. things, other things. Mm-hmm. I think the other team that's offering Lamar guaranteed money is the New York Jets, according to the
Jets wasn't one of them. It was the Falcons, the Texans, and the third one escapes me, but it was not the Jets.
Okay.
Now, the Jets, hey, not saying that the Jets might not get in the fight.
Okay. I know that the money is being offered out there. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, and I think that's why he's going to be holding out.
Yeah. Yeah. A third point would be Diamond, and I hope I don't have this wrong, according to the reports, even from Trump, Diamond and Silk passed away.
Yeah, I heard that.
At age 51.
Right.
And the final point would be the opportunities that are out here as expounded by your first guest. And anecdotally, I'm going to say this. I, as a young man, was growing up, and I had a job and so forth, and I had some problems on that job, and I some apprehensions as to whether I could get it done. And this gentleman, and I appreciated this boss, came to me and said, "Son, you don't have a problem. You have an opportunity." And so I never forgot that, because there are opportunities out there, but are we willing to take advantage of those opportunities?
Well, that's why we had him on, Brother Carlos. Yes. Thank you. Brother Carlos.
I'll say this, that the mayor had a job fair for the squeegee workers, and this is reported in Washington Post on June the 8th, to offer them certain trainings and opportunities, including through the Public Works Program. Now, we want to see if those young people will take the advantage of those opportunities.
You're right.
Out there.
You're right. I agree,
Brother Carlos. That's all I said. Okay, thank you for taking my call. I appreciate it.
More than welcome, Brother Carlos. We appreciate you and respect you. Okay, we're coming to Bill and Charles. I'm going to try to get you in because we're getting ready to go into the next hour. Coming in this order, Bill, Charles, James, and Sarah. Bill, you're on air. Bill?
Hey, first, let me just say good morning to everybody. And let me just say, I want to thank everybody who's constantly fighting, trying to make life better for us as a people. So I just want to give a thank you to all them people that's fighting the best that they can and try to make a difference. I would just like to remind everybody, all the black males listening, that this coming Saturday, tomorrow, Black Man Unifying Black Man, we will be having our breakfast at Terrace Cafe, and it's free. It's from 10 to 12 tomorrow. So all black males is invited to attend, as well as next month, Carl Nelson will be our featured speaker. So I'll be talking about that more next week and in the upcoming weeks. But again, I'm going to just close on this. You know, I keep reminding people, please call City Hall. Complain about your water bills. Because I say this every time I call y'all. People should not be paying $300 and $400 a month for the basic rent just to have water in their homes. And, you know, once we can't afford water, What does that say to us? I mean, how many people tonight is sitting at home, they don't have water because they're too embarrassed to say something. So, you know, they're sitting at home without water. So it's a basic right, it's a human right, and people need to fight for it.
Bill, you're absolutely right. I applaud you. Keep pushing it, because I don't know what's going on that these folk are not adhering to what you're saying about this water bill situation and ain't raising raising enough hell or as much hell as you are raising about it to join you in this fight. And that's what you need. Okay? Appreciate
you, Bill. I appreciate that. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. All right, going to Charles. Charles, you on the air. Charles?
Good morning, everybody. Praise God everlasting almighty for his son, Jesus. I'd just like us to keep an eye on DeSantis down in Florida. He's changing Florida almost over to its own little country. And I'm going to tell you as a veteran why I think he's more dangerous than anybody else. He served in Iraq with SEAL Team 1, and he was an advisor, so he has real-time experience in combat. And I watch how he's changing the laws and stuff down there. And if you look on the national stage, Congress is changing, right? What they're doing is they're making a way for him to actually get at 1600 on Pennsylvania Avenue. That's the same thing that Hitler did, right?
Wait, stop.
All right, sir.
What is Congress doing to make it easier for DeSantis to become president of the United States? What has Congress done to facilitate that, in your opinion?
On the Republican side, they're putting a whole lot of people in charge that have no business there. They're putting a whole lot of people that are like,
What does that have to do with opening the door for DeSantis?
Because in the military, what we do is we use distractions, right, in order to open up opportunity for the real weapon in order to get in place, right? This something as old as time itself, right? And that's what they're doing.
Charles, hold on. I'm going to hold you over because we're getting ready to go to commercial. Because I'm going to hold you over, okay?
All right, sir.
Let me put you on hold. Okay. When we come back, we're coming back to Charles, James, Sarah, Haki has called in maybe to answer some of the Brother Carlos and Tony. This is the Frank M. Conway Sr. et al. Show with co-host Attorney Tamar Smith Wilson, Attorney Robert Bob DeShields, yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas. Don't you touch that dial. We will be right back. Whole lot to talk about.
His father works some days for 14 hours.
Talk in the day. Soul at night.